The story of Much Ado About Nothing.
There lived in the palace at Messina two ladies, whose names were Hero and Beatrice. Hero was the daughter, and Beatrice the niece, of Leonato, the governor of Messina. Beatrice was of a lively temper and loved to divert her cousin Hero, who was of a more serious disposition. At the time our story begins, some young men of high rank in the army were passing through Messina on their way from a war where they had distinguished themselves with great bravery. Those that came to visit Leonato were Don Pedro, the Prince of Aragon, his friend Claudio, and the wild and witty Lord Benedick. He was another rattlebrain, like Beatrice, and these two sharp wits never met, but a perfect ward of raillery was kept up between them. The prince, highly amused at the humorous dialogue between Beatrice and Benedick, said to Leonato, "This is a pleasant-spirited young lady. She were an excellent wife for Benedick." Leonato replied, my lord, if they were but a week married, they would talk themselves mad." But the prince was determined on his plan. Now, the marriage that the prince devised between Beatrice and Benedick was not the only one projected in that good company. Claudio confessed his love for Hero, and the prince lost no time in soliciting the consent of Leonato to accept Claudio for a son-in-law. Leonato agreed, and the marriage day was fixed. To make the time seem short to the impatient Claudio, the prince proposed a kind of merry pastime, that they should invent some artful scheme to make Benedick and Beatrice fall in love with each other. The gentleman should make Benedick believe that Beatrice was in love with him, and Hero and her ladies should make Beatrice believe that Benedick was in love with her. The prince, Leonato, and Claudio began their operations first. They awaited an opportunity where Benedick, seated in an arbour, could not choose but hear all that was said. The prince then asked Leonato, "What was it you told me the other day? That your niece was in love with Signor Benedick? I never did think that lady would have loved any man." Leonato replied, "Nor I. It is most wonderful that she should so dote on Benedick, who she, in all outward behaviour, seemed ever to dislike." Claudio confirmed all this, with saying Hero had told him Beatrice was so in love with Benedick that she would certainly die of grief. The prince affected great compassion for Beatrice. "It were good that Benedick were told of this." "To what end?" said Claudio. "He would but make sport of it and torment the poor lady worse." The prince then motioned to his companions that they should walk on and leave Benedick to meditate on what he had heard. Benedick began to reason with himself. "This can be no trick. They were very serious, and they have the truth from Hero, and seem to pity the lady. Love me? Why? It must be requited. I did never think to marry, but when I said I should die a bachelor, I did not think I should live to be married. But here comes Beatrice. By this day she is a fair lady, and I do spy some marks of love in her." Beatrice now approached him, and said with her usual tartness,
"Against my will, I am sent to bid you come into dinner."
Benedick, who never felt himself disposed to speak so politely to her before, replied, "Fair Beatrice, I thank you for your pains." And when Beatrice, after two or three more rude speeches, left him, Benedick thought he observed a concealed meaning of kindness under the uncivil word she uttered, and he said out loud, "If I do not take pity on her, I am a villain."
Benedick, thus caught in the net, it was now Hero's turn to play her part with Beatrice. Margaret, Hero's gentlewoman, was sent to fetch Beatrice to the orchard. Hero then turned to her other gentlewoman, Ursula, and said, "Now, Ursula, when Beatrice comes, we will walk up and down this alley, and our talk must only be of Benedick and how he is in love with Beatrice." And as it had been with Benedick, so it was with Beatrice, who listened with breathless eagerness to this dialogue, and when they had gone, exclaimed, "What fire is in my ears? Can this be true? Farewell, contempt and scorn, and maiden pride, adieu. Benedick, love on. I will requite you, taming my wild heart to your loving hand."
But now our story takes a sorry turn, and a sad reverse in the fortunes of Hero. The prince had a half-brother, Don John, a melancholy, discontented man, whose spirit seemed to labour in the contriving of villainies. He hated the prince's brother, and Claudio, and was determined to prevent the marriage with Hero. To effect this wicked purpose, he employed one Boraccio, who was courting the gentlewoman Margaret, and prevailed upon him to make Margaret talk to him from her lady's chamber that night, and to dress herself in Hero's clothes. Don John then went to the prince and Claudio, and told him that Hero talked with men from her chamber window at night. He brought them near Hero's window, and they witnessed Margaret talking with Boraccio, and Margaret being dressed in the same clothes they had seen Hero wear, they believed it to be the lady Hero herself.
Nothing could equal the anger of Claudio. All his love for the innocent Hero was at once converted into hatred, and he resolved to expose her in the church next day. As Claudio and Hero were standing before the friar, Claudio, in the most passionate language, proclaimed the guilt of the blameless Hero, who sank down in a fainting fit. The prince and Claudio then left the church. Hero recovered from her swoon and said, "Oh, my father, if you can prove that any man has ever conversed with me at hours unmeet, or that I, yesternight, changed words with any creature, refuse me, hate me, torture me to death."
The friar then spoke. "There is some strange misunderstanding in the prince and Claudio." He then counseled Leonato that he should report that Hero was dead, so Claudio would mourn and in time wish that he had not so accused her. The plan was agreed, and Hero and Leonato led away, leaving Beatrice and Benedick alone. Benedick was the first who spoke. "Lady Beatrice, have you wept all this while?"
"Yes, and I will weep a little longer."
"Surely I do believe your fair cousin is wronged."
"Oh, how much might that man deserve of me who would write her?"
"Is there any way to show such friendship? I do love nothing in the world so well as you. Is not that strange?"
"It were as possible for me to say I loved nothing in the world so well as you."
"By my sword, you love me, and I protest I love you. Come, bid me do anything for you."
"Kill Claudio. My sweet Hero is wronged. She is slandered. She is undone. Oh, that I were a man for Claudio's sake, or that I had a friend who would be a man for my sake."
"Think you on your soul that Claudio has wronged Hero?"
"Yea, as sure as I have a thought or a soul."
"Enough. I am engaged. I will challenge him."
But the justice of heaven brought better proof of the innocence of Hero than the uncertain fortune of a duel. A magistrate brought Boraccio before the prince, who made a full confession of Don John's plot. If a suspicion had remained about Don John's villainy, it was removed by his flight. For Don John, finding his villainies detected, fled from Messina. The heart of Claudio was sorely grieved, and he implored forgiveness of Leonato for the injury and, as he believed, the death he had caused his child. Leonato demanded a penance, and this was to marry, the next day, a cousin of Hero's, now his heir. The next morning, Leonardo presented Claudio with his promised bride, who was masked. Claudio said,
"Give me your hand before this holy friar. I am your husband, if you will marry me."
"And when I loved, I was your other wife." Then this unknown lady, taking off her mask, proved to be no niece, but the lady hero herself. Claudio, who had thought her dead, could scarcely for joy believe his eyes.
"Is not this hero? Hero that was dead?" Leonardo replied, "She died, my lord, but while her slander lived."
There was further surprise for the assembled company, for Benedick desired to be married as well, to Beatrice. So these two mad wits were finally matched.
And to complete the story, Don John was taken in flight and brought back to Messina. And brave punishment it was to this gloomy, discontented man to see the great joy and merry feastings which, by the disappointment of his plots, took place at the palace in Messina.